turning out. Of course, continue praying. Where is Archie and Lindsay? Are they here yet? Continue praying for the, of course, the situation we're in. You know, like I'm telling people, you're not going to get faltered forever how you feel. Don't use this as an excuse to go back on God now and get lazy on God. I was talking to my wife this morning. Of course, been doing a lot of study. Makes it sound like I'm real. But I've been reading a little, you know, and I think that we've slipped into a time that sometimes we get into where we live by our standards rather than God's standards. But there they are. Boy, you're just in time. Ain't no sense in sitting down. Come on up here. Lindsay, listen. Look, Lindsay, come on up here. Ain't no sense sitting down. You and Archie, come on, James, Jennifer. We're going to get started. Of course, Brother Roger's going to be preaching this morning. Man, he got one of them big coffee table Bibles, don't he? I'd hate for him to get turned loose and whack me upside the head with that. But if you feel the need to hit Charlotte, go right ahead, you know. This morning, I want to take just a minute to recognize our graduates. Of course, we had a little thing Wednesday with them. And, they worked so hard, and they did get robbed. I mean, you know, you spend all that time, but I want you guys to know I'm proud of you and I love you. And your pastor's always here for you. Of course, did you get whatever the church is? Okay. You got my back. All right. Of course, I brought, y'all come on, stand up next to me here. I better put two masks on these leaders. Jennifer and James has taken over. You know, the church went, well, through things, and they stepped up as our youth leaders and have done a great job, great, great job. And, of course, they're moving on up. We got other areas in the church that we're needing them in. And so Archie and Lindsay is now part, and here in the near future, I think that Archie and Lindsay is going to, we're just going to let them take and run with it. And, of course, these two will always be a part of it, but we got to have them. Right now, they're a team, and I want them to, so that's the reason I brought all four of them up here. Real quick, I want them just to call up one of you, Archie, you can, or Jennifer, don't make a difference. Call them up, who's graduating, and let's give them a hand of applause. I mean, bless their heart. They work so hard, and it's not fair. And, guys, it is. But your pastor appreciates you, and I love you, and I'm always here for you. And so one of you, just get up here and call him up here, and we'll.
Well, I don't know about this, especially that one on the back row. I don't know if I want him up here or not. Did somebody sterilize him before he come in here?
Man, we can get him a motor oil.
Let's go ahead and get Carly and Zach up here. Haven't had, I guess, probably about a year now with these two. I told them Wednesday that I didn't care how old they were, that they were always welcome to come to the youth group if they wanted to. Amen. I'm wondering if that might be a mistake, but it's a good bunch of kids. Of course, we have an excellent bunch of kids, the whole lot of them, but these two, like we talked about, of course Carly wasn't here, she skipped out in her own party, but we talked a little bit Wednesday there about how things are about to change, and you don't realize that when you're, like I told them, the summer after I graduated felt a whole lot like that I was still in high school. But as soon as that summer's over and it's time to sink or swim, so to speak, and you have to move on with life, things change really fast. And the mistake that some of us make sometimes is in the midst of all that change, we forget about God. And we go off and we do our own thing, or the church doesn't support us, or whatever it may be. Here, luckily, we have of course, they can stay in the youth as long as they want, but we have an excellent collegiate program as well. Don't mistake collegiate for meaning that you have to be in college. It's just the age, and you can you just hop right in there. It's an excellent program, but we need to make sure that we surround these guys as they graduate and as they move on, because it's really easy once you graduate, once you get mixed up in life, to move away from the church. And it may take many, many years for them to circle back around if they ever make it back. Now, I'm not worried about these two, but if you know a graduate, make sure that you surround them with that love and that direction. Keep them kind of, you can't tell them what to do anymore, but you can kind of move them over to where they need to be. So, of course, we have some things to give these two. This guy's kind of smiling all the time. We presented them with Bibles from the pastor there Wednesday, and we have a little something for each of them here. Jennifer's going to hand to them.
That's from the church, guys.
But just love them and guide them and always be there for them. Whatever you got to do, if they're allowed to miss a Sunday or two, but if they miss much more than that, go to their house.
Amen. 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 No.
We love you guys, and whatever the future holds, we know it's great with you all.
Yeah.
Well, you and you. I give Zach a hard time, but.
But, well, we do. We want to, again, say congratulations and to everybody that's maybe listening that's got kids. But now, you wasn't here, you laid out on this Wednesday. So, this is for my wife and myself. I can present you a car, it'll eventually fall apart. I can give you a house, it'll eventually fall down. I give you money and it'll eventually be gone, but that'll stay with you through eternity. So I would encourage you to search the scriptures and you'll find treasure there. All right. What I'm going to ask them to do, y'all, let's stand up. If you couldn't live, just come to the front of the church. Yeah, y'all can do better than that now. Yeah, y'all can do better than that.
For our tithes and offerings, we will be, there'll be people standing in each one. I got up this morning and preached a little bit on tithes and offerings. I forgot to take up an offering. Well, glory. So that'll be going on. Of course, got a lot of things going on. Brother Roger will be preaching this morning, the 11 o'clock. I preached the 9 o'clock. My voice just won't carry two services that quick. So I don't know why, but Roger, you don't know how much I appreciate you, brother. This time, if we would, who's going to sing? Come on and sing, ladies, gentlemen. Johnny done his part. He gets out of bed, gets over here and sing. That means y'all can come on up and sing now. Where's Pete at? Yeah, I was going to wear old Pete out, but no, him and Pat got to go down and spend last weekend with their grandbaby, and I know that's been a trip that's been looked for. So it's good to have y'all back. Love you. Love you. So listen, if you're here this morning, you're lost, you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I don't know a better day. I don't know of a better day. If you're here this morning and boy, the weight of this world's just got you bound down, you're not living that victorious life, come and claim your victory this morning. Amen. Roger, when they get done, you just take it over, brother.
Before we get started, our son-in-law's dad was taken to the hospital yesterday. They found out he's got some kind of heart issue, so they're going to be doing a heart cath on him in the morning. And Brother Kenny Hayes, I think most everybody here knows who he is, has been having some issues for the last several weeks, not doing well, feeling sick. So everybody pray for him also. Just keep both of them in your prayers.
On that resurrection morning, when the redeemed are gathering in, I'll be in that royal number. When they call my name, when they'll all join in and sing hallelujah to the King, I'll cry with a joyful sound, Lord, here I am, here I am, here I am. I'm the one the shepherd left the fold and found. There were 90 and 9, but he left the fold to find one little lost lamb, and here I am. When old Gabriel blows the trumpet and we rise up in the air, in less time than a split second, we'll be changed from here to there, where there'll be no grief or pain. Perfect peace and joy shall reign. Home at last I shall proclaim, Lord, here I am, here I am.
Of which I can claim, but because I have Jesus, I have everything. His love is more precious than earthly fortune and fame. Heading for a city, not made. Son of God in glory land. Death is a stranger, and there cometh no night. I'm heading for a city where my Lord is the light. Before Christ ascended back to this mother above, he sent a promise. A promise of love. He said, I'd come back to earth again to take my children home, home to that city where God reigns on the throne. Headed for a city not made by man, Son of God in glory land, a place where death is a stranger, and there cometh no night. I'm heading for a city where my Lord is the light. Heading for a city not made Son of God in glory land, a place where death is a stranger, and there cometh no night. I'm headed for a city where my Lord is the upon the mountain, why transfiguration? An angel of the Lord said this could be the day. He said, don't stand there a grieving for the ones that you see a leaving, for like matter he's coming. He's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud that it's gonna raise the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he's gonna split those eastern skies. And I believe he's coming back. I believe the time is nearing that I'll soon see his appearing. This could be the hour, oh, this could be the day that the saints of every nation shall lose their gravitation in the middle of the earth, be called away. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud that it's gonna raise the dead. He's gonna split those eastern skies, and I believe he's coming back like he said. I just wanna thank you, Lord, for everything. that you heard me pray. I just want to thank you for always being there. And when I was so down and down, you came along and made me want to shout. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And if I had a thousand lives to live,
would you live,
I'd give them all to you, Lord. Cause you've been so good to me. That is the least that I can afford. Cause you made the good times outnumber the bad, and you've been the best friend that I've ever had. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord, for every time that you heard me pray. I just wanna thank you for always being there. And when I was so down and down, you came along and made me wanna shout. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And if I had a thousand lives to live, I'd give them all to you, Lord. Cause you've been so good to me. That is the least that I can afford. But you've made the good times outnumber the bad, and you've been the best friend that I've ever had. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord, for every time that you heard me pray. I just wanna thank you for always being there. And when I was so down and down, you came along and made me wanna shout. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Sent down from heaven, rescued me from sin and from shame. Opened up my eyes and brought salvation. Now I'm His, praise His holy name. Now I know He is mine, and He is forever.
He is leading me,
leading me along this way.
Well, He'll be holding into
my hand
when I cross
this river. Have Jesus. Jesus with me, he will keep me free from sin and strife. He delivered me from condemnation. Now I have eternal life.
Well, now I know that he is
mine. I am his forever.
He is leading me.
He will take this thing away.
Now I know he is
forever.
The glory of Jehovah. Paul preached that all is lost save knowing Christ. Little John said he's precious while leaning on his bosom. For a moment, may I humbly testify. Did I mention that I love him?
Do you love the Lord this morning?
I worship.
The Lord always been there for you. Always took care of everything.
When I can see no way, he made a way. And did I mention that he's been faithful to every promise he's ever made me? I love him, that's all I want to say. How many sermons has been preached about this Jesus? How many songs has been sung about God's Son? There are not enough words, enough notes in the music to tell the story of all my Savior has done. Did I mention that I love him? How I worship and adore him? When I can see no way, he makes a way. He's been faithful to every promise he ever made me. I love him, that's all I want to say. He's been faithful to every promise he ever made me. I love him, that's all I want to say.
best sermon that can be preached are those who will come this morning and get on this old-fashioned altar. Preachers can bring the word, but the best word is the one when the Holy Spirit has a time to draw in unto the people this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me for just a moment to James chapter 1. I want to talk this morning about putting your trust in God. Putting your trust in God. A proven faith is one that trusts God. Because you've been through these trials and tribulations and problems and things that James wants us to know about as a way to have patience during this time of trouble. A lot of people say they trust the Lord, but do you really? Yeah, you can say that with your lips, I trust you, Lord. I trust you're going to lead me. I trust you, Lord, you're going to take care of this problem for me. And a day later, you're giving up on that trust. Trust is a thing that you earn sometimes. I was asking Danny this morning for his wallet there just as, let me see that a minute, brother. Do you trust me? So if I wanted to pass out what's in this wallet this morning, you'd be okay with that. See? Where did that trust it? I didn't get 6 foot. And I don't even know what's in there. Probably more lint than anything in it, Sheila. But do we really trust the Lord here this morning? Not just with our lips. I mean your total trust of the Lord. Now we know, brother, you had an issue here this past week. It doesn't take long for that worry to overcome trust. Say amen. Amen. Worry will take you to a place where you forget about trust. Worry will take you where you forget about the love that the Lord has for you. You get to where the worry and Satan overtakes you to where you can't even pray. You stay up all night thinking about your worry. Then where is your trust? We're all guilty. Don't get me wrong here this morning. But this trust comes through believing not in the material things, but in the spiritual things. It's when you get down on old bended knees and you're praying to the Lord with a fervent heart of understanding, and that trust starts building and the confidence starts building that allows you to believe in that trust and proven faith. Many of us have a little age on us. We can remember where we've been through some times and when God brought us through those things, all because He felt that we had enough confidence in Him to answer our need. Everybody say amen this morning. Don't shut up on the amens this morning. God is looking for you to praise Him here this morning. And when you trust Him, you're going to believe what I'm telling you here this morning. So if I passed out what you have in here, you'd still be okay with it. Let me get over here. Still okay with it? How about you ladies and what you got in your purse? I won't just make this a man thing. Do you really trust? You know, a lot of people will let you down. Everybody say amen. Family, children. They'll let you down in some form. You'll say, well, I never thought they'd do that. I really trusted they'd be okay with that. I didn't think they'd ever do that. But did you really trust them? See, we can use that word so frivolously about this word trust. Spouses and wives and so forth, trust amongst the family, amongst what God has ordained as a marriage relationship. God has trusted us with a lot of things. But what are you trusting Him with? He's given you everything you had need of, not what you once were, you know, but what was your trust that God was going to take care of your situation? That's the thing we fight the most is our situation. We don't know when God's going to answer that, so we give up on Him answering things. And then we lose our trust in Him. That's what I want to try to bring a little message on this morning is, if we really trust Him, we would let Him be number one in our lives. Amen. We would put God first here this morning. God first means it ain't the mountains, it ain't the lakes, it ain't the things that we own, but it's putting God first in every decision that we make. Find out where you're at in your relationship with the Lord to have God first. And a lot of people use that term too frivolously also. Well, I put him first whenever I got a problem, or I'll put him first when the kids are sick, or I'll put him first whenever something breaks down in the house and I got to replace it or whatever. You got to put God first. I'm guilty too, brother. Yeah. I get guilty of that too. Patience. Not patient enough. My wife will tell you I'm not patient enough. But I still have trust in the Lord. See, you can have the physical part of impatience, but that don't mean it has to get you away from your trust in the Lord. You know, the old song says, trust and obey, for there's no other way, but through Jesus, there's trust. This man trust. I'll give this back to you, brother. I won't give it out. Good thing we don't have slider cards or that little square thing. He's kept old Benjamin there so long, he calls him by another name now. James in verse 1 says, James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into these divers temptations in verse 2. Well, I was okay until that car broke down and I had to put a new transmission in it. I was okay when I had to replace that garage door yesterday and have it repaired yesterday. I was okay while those things were going good, but can you trust Him and praise Him when things aren't going good? Amen. Are you just going to stay up and worry all night? Preach it, brother. Yeah. Sometimes you can't even go to sleep because you can't get it out of your mind, your problem that's going on, or the thing that you just wish would change, and the devil's going to use that sleeplessness to make you even more worried and worried and worried. How do we get over these things? You learn to trust in the Lord. Yeah. You say, well, it's easy for you. You're not fighting what I'm going through. How do you know? Amen? We don't know what your burdens are, but I know somebody who does. And when you trust in Him, it's going to be okay. I can tell you that, Patrick, but it's going to be okay, Brother Danny. Things will work out okay for you. You know, it's whenever we got so much worry that God comes through and answers that prayer that you had a need for. I just didn't think it was going to work out, and then all at once the window shade pops up and the light comes in, and God says it's going to be okay. You ought to give the Lord a hand on that this morning. Verse 3 says, knowing that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Boy, you should say, well, I ought to be the patient as Job. With all the trials that I've been through and the problems that I've been through, I ought to be the most patient one in the world. But we aren't. Amen. James, a lot of theologians say James was one of the first gospels of the New Testament. I don't know if that's true or not, but a lot of theologians think it is. But James was trying to tell us here in these letters that he was writing to the church. He says things are going to be hard. Things are going to be tough. But I can tell you a way to get through these. Patience is the biggest one. And prayer. The effectual, fervent prayer. Brother Danny preached this morning. We're going to have a prayer thing going on here in our Wednesday night class here in a few weeks or so. Whenever we do that, this church ought to fill up on bended knees for prayer, and then you'll gain that trust that God has for every one of us. Trust is earned, but you don't have to earn it with Jesus Christ. It's freely given. But the trust trust He has in you, you have to earn. He's not going to give you anything with confidence knowing that you're going to abuse it or not use it. God's trust only comes through the prayer and the righteousness that only He can give us. He says in verse 4, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. What do we want? Why do we try to get our pocketbooks or our bank accounts ahead of what God's doing for us? We ain't even guaranteed tomorrow. Many of us are living still in the past, what happened a year ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, but why not start living for the future that God has promised every one of us? Then you'll understand what I'm saying here this morning about trust. Trust. You got to have trust when things look bleak. Don't we, sister? We got to have times whenever separations are there. We got to have those times of confidence that you have in the Lord. I've had a lot of people tell me over the years, I have a lot of confidence. No, I have a lot of strength, but what God gives me is confidence. I can't make my own confidence, but I can tell you what I've gotten through, and that'll give you confidence. Amen. I like verse 5. It says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and braideth not, and it shall be given to him. Now, you want to learn trust, that Bible that you gave Carly there, she can gain confidence and trust just from reading between the lines of those scriptures. And God will reveal to her, Archie and Lindsay, in this youth group, God will reveal to them what he wants them to do as a plan for their lives. You'll say, well, how's that going to be that he 2,000 years ago could tell me how my children were going to be raised? Well, he can't. You know what's wrong with today's society? Families are not raising their children anymore. Everybody say amen. The computers are doing it, right? You can go and do what we want to do, but the computer will take care of the kid as the babysitter part of that life. But what about the time when they should be breaking open that Bible? Here on Wednesday nights, and you don't bring them. I'm preaching to everybody. Yeah. Times, people, you young people, listen to what these two are trying to tell you about how this God, Jesus Christ, can change your life for the better. Many of us would say probably in our walk of life that if we had things to do over, we'd do them differently. Would you? If you had that insight, you had that wisdom, you'd do something differently. I've heard that so many times over the years. You know, I'd have went to school, I'd have got this education, I'd have got that education. I'd have married this person and not that person. Everybody say, uh-oh. But look at your own selves and your own family, where you're at today. Don't worry about what happened last year, last month, last 2 years, 5 years. Look where you are this week. Have you lived for the Lord? Have you trusted the Lord? This virus thing that we've got should be having everybody looking for a different trust than what the government is offering us. I don't trust. I believe, like you said, brother, you can hear one thing on this channel, another on that channel, and one from this PhD and another from that one. Believe what God is telling you. This too, every season in the Bible was overcome through God's strength. And we're going to get through this with God's strength because of our trust in him. Why should we not put God first and really mean it? And everybody say amen. Don't get quiet on me. Have you put him first this week? This past week? We're going into another week here tomorrow. Is God still going to be first in your lives? You say, well, you know, I didn't know the house was going to need a new roof, and I didn't know the air conditioner was going to go out, and I didn't know the car was going to break down. I didn't know all this was going to happen. Know this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Have you even asked the Lord to give you patience during this time so that worry don't overtake you? Yeah, you may make some mistakes along the way, but your patience and confidence get stronger in trust. When you know God's going to take care of it either way. I wish I could change some things in our lives that would make people see the real value of this word, that the preachers have such a desire for people to grow in his word, and yet they're not growing the way that they should. They're still living as the day they got saved. And they haven't grown in God's word. That's why when the tragedies and the problems come, They don't know how to handle them. But God's word will teach them and tell you how to handle these things. Trust in me, he says. But lest him, in verse 6, ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Several times in the New Testament, Jesus sent the disciples out in the boat. He sent them into the storm. But every time that he did that, he came through in the storm. But he had to send them through the storm first. What storm are you fighting here this morning? What battle are you facing? Or what battle is your friends facing that you've lost trust God's going to change it? God can change everything. With God, nothing is impossible. Doesn't the Bible say in Romans 8 that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to those who are called according to his purpose? What are you trusting in this morning? Not your job. Your job can be taken away. Are you trusting in your health? It can also be taken away with one diagnosis. Trusting in your children, parents? What are you trusting in this morning instead of trusting in the Lord first? I'm just trying to get your mind focused this morning to what God wants you to be. Not who you want to be. Don't get that confused. But what he wants you to be. We set up ourselves for failure a lot of times, trying to strive for things that really ain't what the Lord's wanting us to be anyway. But have you ever asked yourself, what can I do for you, Lord? Everybody say amen this morning. What do you want me to do, Lord? People say, well, I just don't know what the will of God is in my life. I just don't know how I should live my life. When's the last time you opened the book to find out? Search the scriptures wherein they speak of me. It'll tell you how you need to live your life. People are professing themselves to be Christians, but their heart is far from it. Many times the disciples and people were following Jesus. He was feeding them. He was healing them. He was taking care of their needs. But then he told them how they had to live their life. The Bible says over 600 of them departed from him, not to walk with him anymore. Where was that trust? They were just getting from the Lord what they wanted, but then when they had to live their life the way he wanted, they departed from it, Danny. What are you doing for him this morning? What has he already done this past week that you haven't praised him for? Amen? You want to see your grandbaby? Bless him, wouldn't it? Hug around the neck. Mama or Papa. Mom or Dad. Hug around your neck. Knowing true love is there. Or you have children and you haven't even hugged their neck this past week. What are you trusting in? Trust not on your own self. And lean not on your own understanding, the Bible said. That's what messes up everything. We start trying to lean on our own understanding. I can handle this. I can take care of this. No matter what comes, I can take care of it. Then God shows you, you can't take care of it. You're like those little pea ants that the Bible talks about. They have nothing but to work. We need to become little ants and start being more workers for the Lord. Everybody say amen. That's where our church is going to grow going forward here. I'm telling you. God is going to open some doors, but he wants to open it for those who will work with him to win souls and be a part of that trust here this morning. How can you learn that? I can't tell you. You know, in school they teach you a lot of things, but till you get out into the real world and start doing them, you say, well, the schooling didn't really teach me too much. Because then you got to face all that learning curve of things that they didn't teach you in school. Well, church will teach you some things if you open your mind to the Lord to learn them. Got a few more minutes here. Verse 7 says, for let not a man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. You mentioned this morning. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You can't be a Christian today and live like a hell tomorrow. Amen. You can't say that you love this word, you love this trust, and then go out tomorrow and shame it with the way that you live your life. Now, I'm not talking about attitudes or any of that type of stuff. I'm talking about how do people see you in the light. Trust. You should trust no one except God. Well, I trust them. No, you really don't. You ever been taken by a contractor or somebody before? Well, I trusted he'd be good. He seemed like he was anyway. Do we lean upon our own understanding when it comes to our needs rather than asking for what God wants us to have? You ever bought anything and said, Lord, do you want me to have this? Then you weren't even all the way home. You had second thoughts about wanting it. Everybody say amen. Well, there comes that big old book that'll choke a goat to make them payments on. Well, I didn't think the other car was going to break down. I wouldn't even bought that one. See, we start reasoning within ourselves about what God is truly involved in. But God is involved in everyone's lives that came out here this morning in some form. God gave you strength. You may have had aches and pains. You may have had something going on in your life, and you say, well, I just don't really feel like going to church this morning. But when you say those things, you forgot about trust. You put yourself then ahead of what God wanted you to hear this morning. You may not want to hear me, and that's okay. But did you want to hear God? Did you want to feel that small voice talking to you in the back of your head? I just wish things would change today. And God wants to hear it from you this morning. He wants to hear you say that I want to know you, Lord. You've been sitting on that pew too long. And God's been drawing you, and you've been holding on those little holes in the back of your seat there, not letting go enough to get out and come out here to the Lord and know Him in the free pardon of sin and get that trust that will come through the preaching of God's holy word. You think ministers are a flaming fire? No, they're a word of the truth. And the word that we speak are true. We're not putting our own doctrine upon these things. Let a brother of low degree, it says in verse 9, rejoice in that he is exalted. We will be exalted one of these days. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and I'll be out there on the Hallelujah Choir with you, being exalted, not for me, but exaltation to the King, Jesus Christ. The Bible says we'll receive crowns. I'm going to cast mine down, as the Bible says, at his feet. I don't want your crown, Jesus. I just want to thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me. What you did on that cross at Calvary, when you carried it all the way to Calvary with sweat and tears and blood going down into your sweat and tears, you were doing it for me. I just want to thank you, Lord. But also there's going to be those who will appear who Jesus will say, depart from me. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. For I never knew you. I called and you didn't answer. I drew and you didn't receive. And it doesn't have to be that way. Families, we've got to get our children in church. We've got to quit just wondering if they're going to be okay and do okay. We got to first lead them into the church. I grew up in church. My grandmother I lived with for quite a while drug me to church. Sat in old split rail pews and learned to know about this man, Jesus. Little did I know that I'd become a preacher one day. But God did. My grandmother did. She gave me some values. And once you learn values, then you'll learn trust for the Lord. One more minute, we'll let the singers come. But the rich in verse 10, in that he has made low because as the flower of the grass he shall pass away. For the sun is no sooner risen with burning heat, but it withereth the grass. And then he says, the flower thereof falleth, and the grace of the fashion of it perisheth, and also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. Where do we want to be in all sincerity? There's nothing wrong with having a nice house, a nice car, and these things. But you got every one of those because of what God gave you. You didn't earn them. You think we did, working our hours that we do and so forth. But every one of those came because God had enough confidence to give them to you. But we can lose every one of them tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow is, but we know who holds tomorrow. And when you do can answer that properly, you've learned trust. You know, when a little baby, you try to guide him when he's walking, learning to walk, he's stumbling and so forth. And then you take your hands off of him, and eventually he just takes off going. That's all because you had trust that he can now do it. Trust is hard to understand without faith. Trust is hard to understand without proving of that faith. And probably everybody in here has some testimony of how God's proved to you that he is real. Let's make Jesus real in our lives going forward here. We get over this virus, fill this church up with God's praise, fill this church up with God's wonderment, fill this church up with souls being saved, fill this church up with the people with a desire of happiness and joy, fill it up with what God will provide if we'll just let him. We ought to be able to pass out chairs here. We get so full of people wanting to know about this man Jesus and the trust that he can give to each one of us. Blessed is the man, here in closing, that endureth, in verse 12, temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. What are you after this morning? That crown, that love him. Love and trust go hand in hand. Faith and trust go hand in hand. And trying goes in with patience. That's what I want to leave you with this morning. Think about this week, how you can change your outlook of trusting him. And let's make him first. Singers, won't you come, please? Brother Danny, I want to turn it back over to you here this morning. If you have a need or desire, please step out this morning. Don't deny that calling. We'll pray with you. We'll tell you how to get to know him. And we'll tell you how that all these teachers and deacons and preachers will help lead you in your future life with praise and honor this morning.
I can't even walk
stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. One day I made Jesus my all and all. Whenever I'm in trouble, on his name I call. 'Cause if I don't trust in him, I'd be less than a man, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. No, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. You'll see the mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
It's impossible to walk on this earth without holding Jesus' hand. You'll sink every time. Amen. Amen. It is I tell you guys, y'all make my day. I love you all so much. Of course, we've got Regina and